Welcome to another video about the Nordic Saints. This one, the last of three, is about the most famous of them all, our very own Scandinavian saintly superstar, Saint Birgitta, also known as Bridget. Birgitta was born around 1303 in Uppsala, Sweden, into one of the most powerful and influential noble families in the country. Her father, Birger Persson, was a knight, part of the Privy Council and Lawman of Uppland. Birgittas mother, Ingeborg Bengtsdotter, was related to the royal family. Birgitta was thus, from the beginning, smack bang in the middle of political power. From an early age, Birgitta had religious visions. Once, when she was just 6 years old, she awoke in the night, and on the other side of the bed, she saw an altar, on which sat a woman in shining clothes. She held a crown in her hand. The woman told the little girl to come to her. She then asked her if she wanted the crown, and when Birgitta nodded, the woman placed it upon her head. She interpreted the woman as the Virgin Mary. In a dream a few years later, she had another vision. This time, she saw Jesus crucified, and he told her, "It is in this way that I have been tormented." Birgitta asked him who had done this to him, and he answered, "Those who despise me and care not for my love." After this, Birgitta could not think about the suffering of Christ without crying. In September 1314, Birgitta's mother died, and she was sent away to be raised by her aunt, Kristina Bengtsdotter, and her husband. Her visions continued. One night, her aunt found her at the foot of her bed, crying and praying. When asked what she was doing, Birgitta answered that she had risen to praise him who always helps me. On another occasion, when she was playing with her friends, a devil showed himself to her. He had 100 hands and feet, and Birgitta ran off, terrified. He later showed himself to her again, but confessed that he could do nothing without consent from the crucified one. All this was taken very seriously. A young girl seeing demons and getting apparitions that no one knew where they came from. Her aunt Katarina asked her to keep them quiet. Maybe she was possessed by the devil. In September 1316, when Birgitta was around 13 years old, she was married to Ulf Gudmarsson, the son of another powerful lawman. He was 18 at the time and would eventually be made lawman himself in Närke. Birgitta and her new husband settled down on a property called Ulvåsa in Östergötland. Of the old manor, only ruins of the cellar remain, but looking at other contemporary buildings, it might have looked something like this. In Birgitta's own texts, you get a sense that she longed for chastity, and maybe she would rather have become a nun, or at least be in a marriage without any sexual relations. However, she and Ulf would have 8 children together. She gave birth to their first child, Märta, when she was only 16 years old. During the next 18 years, another 7 children followed. When she was pregnant with the youngest, Cecilia, her eldest daughter Märta was married off against Birgitta's will to a man called Sigvid Ribbing, who Birgitta truly detested. She is said to have been furious with her husband and suffered crying fits as results. To be upset when pregnant was seen as bad for the child, and according to Birgitta, during one of these crying spells, her unborn daughter called to her, "Dearest mother, do not kill me." According to a later source, this supposedly happened during the wedding between Märta and Sigvid, which Birgitta had refused to attend. But when her unborn child begged her, she gathered herself and joined the feast. Birgitta performed the worldly duties of running her large household and raising her children, as well as the spiritual duties of worship and charity. She had built a hospital and is said to have personally cared for the sick. Birgitta's daughter Katarina later recalled that her mother went to brothels and rescued women and educated them in how to live a pious and righteous life. She is also said to have fed 12 poor people in her house every day and to have served them herself. As mentioned, Birgitta was related to the royal family. In 1335, the king, Magnus Eriksson, married Blanche of Namur, and Birgitta was made principal lady-in-waiting to the new queen. She would, for many years, wield substantial influence over the royal couple. Birgitta and her husband Ulf made two pilgrimages together. The first one took place sometime in the second half of the 1330s and was a journey to the grave of Sankt Olav in Nidaros, today called Trondheim. They walked all the way there on foot. The second pilgrimage was to Santiago de Compostela in Spain and took place in 1341-42. On this journey, Ulf fell ill and came close to dying. Then, Saint Dionysus appeared to Birgitta and said, "Since you show me such love, I want to tell you that God wants to be known in the world through you. You have been left under my protection, and therefore I will always help you. As a sign of that, your husband will not die of this disease." Ulf recovered, and they could go on together. After their return to Sweden, they left Ulvåsa and settled in a residence close to the Cistercian monastery, Alvastra. There, Ulf died, sometime between 1344 and 1346. After his death, Birgitta received another vision, in which God appointed her to be his bride and channel. Birgitta is said to have been fearful of her visions, since she didn't know if they were truly from God or if it was the devil who tempted her. But in this vision, God told her to go to her confessor, Master Matthias, since he was skilled in distinguishing the difference. And Matthias did indeed attest that the visions came from God himself. Around the same time, Birgitta's influence at court increased, and she also got the idea, from Jesus, of course, that the royal residence in Vastena would be a perfect place for a new monastic order. However, founding a monastery was not easy. Large sums of money and land were required. Her good relations with the royal couple meant that they donated both. In 1348, Birgitta began propagating for a crusade to be made to convert the heathens of Finland. Worth to remember in this context is that Birgitta saw this as an act of love that would save the unfaithful from eternal condemnation. Even though those that didn't convert should be killed, this was also a good thing according to Birgitta's visions, because if they lived longer, they would sin more and thus be punished worse in hell. She gave clear instructions to the king. The soldiers must truly believe in their cause and obey God's will in all things. Except for the warfare itself, they should treat women and children well, and there would be no plunder, burning or villages or other misdeeds. The crusade began in 1348 and was first successful. The heathens were defeated and converted. After this, Magnus Eriksson left a small garrison and returned to Sweden. However, the people had just pretended to embrace the true faith and reverted once the threat was gone. At the beginning of 1349, they defeated the small garrison left behind. According to Birgitta, this was because the king had not obeyed God in all things and gone about it the wrong way. Another attempt was made in 1350, but also failed. Birgitta again blamed the king, and it was at this point that her relationship with the royal couple began to falter. Later in life, she would write very nasty letters to and about the king, amongst other things, accusing him of sleeping with men. Amidst all this, Birgitta still had her dream about founding a new monastic order, but to achieve this, she had to have the Pope's approval. In 1349, she had a vision where Jesus urged her to go to Rome to await the Pope's return. At this time, the Pope, Clement VI, did not live in Rome, but in Avignon in France. But Jesus told Birgitta that he would return to Rome and that she should be there when he did. So in the autumn of 1349, she left Sweden, never to return. In Rome, Birgitta made both powerful friends and powerful enemies. She was not afraid to criticize anything or anyone that Jesus, Mary, or angels told her to. She was apparently called a witch by some, and she wanted to leave the hostile city, but Jesus reassured her that he wouldn't let anything happen to her. Jesus also had rather a strict schedule that she had to follow. 8 hours of sleep every night, and then she should rise at 4 o'clock in the morning. Then she should spend 4 hours praying or other pious activities, after which a maximum of 2 hours were allowed for eating. Then 6 hours every day where she performed a variety of tasks, such as visiting churches or hospitals, studying, writing down her visions, or needlework. Thereafter, 2 hours of evening mass, and then an evening meal, also maximum of 2 hours. Although Birgitta was both rich and powerful, she was not the master of the household, according to contemporary sources. Her confessor, Peter Olofsson, decided if and when she was allowed to leave the house, how much money she was allowed to spend, and could even harshly correct her, all of which she apparently accepted. Birgitta had to wait a long time in Rome for the Pope to finally return, like Jesus had promised. First, in 1367, the Pope, Urban V, moved back to the city. There he met with the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles IV, something that Birgitta had prophesied about even before she left Sweden. This gave her much respect and credibility, and she was invited to meet the Pope himself. She could now finally persuade him to allow her to found the new monastic order she had dreamt of for 2 decades. And in 1370, he did grant her the right to found her monastery, but with a modification. Birgitta had wanted a monastery for both men and women, which would all be subordinate to the abbess. The Pope, however, only granted a founding of 2 gender-segregated monasteries. That must have been a great disappointment for Birgitta. And yet another disappointment would soon follow. The Pope decided to abandon Rome and return to Avignon. Birgitta was furious, and the Virgin Mary told her that if he continued on this path, he would soon receive a blow that causes his teeth to loosen or grind, his vision to dim and darken, and all the limbs of his body to tremble. No one else dared give this prediction to Urban V, so Birgitta did it herself. It didn't help, however, and in August 1370, he left Rome. A few months later, he fell ill and died on December 19th. Again, Birgitta's prediction turned out to be true. In 1371, Birgitta, almost 70 years old, received an order from Jesus to make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. In November, a large company set out towards the Holy Land, including Birgitta's 2 sons, Karl and Birger. Of the two, Birger was a pious man, but Karl was vain and worldly, and Birgitta was worried for his soul. On the journey, he fell ill and died. Although she loved her son, she was rather relieved that they could no longer live in sin. In a vision, an angel told her that her tears for her son had wiped his sins away and that he had been saved from eternal damnation. Birgitta and her company arrived in Jerusalem in May 1372 and spent the next few months visiting all the holy sites. She had a constant flow of visions and wrote them all down, making this one of the most productive periods in her life. In one vision, she saw Virgin Mary give birth to Jesus, and in another, Jesus forgave her all her sins. After about 4 months, they began journeying back to Rome. After their return, in the spring of 1373, Birgitta felt old and sick. However, she still had one mission left, and it remained the same as it had been for over 2 decades. To get the Pope to return to Rome. She kept writing him letters and giving him Jesus' instructions, but she never got to see his return for herself. On July 23rd, 1373, Birgitta died. Her children, Birger and Katarina, were at her deathbed and later arranged for her body to be brought back to Sweden to be laid to rest at a monastery in Vastena. It would be a long journey, almost a year, before they finally arrived. But the story of Birgitta does not end here. After her death, a campaign began to have her canonized. Her daughter Katarina went back to Rome and oversaw the proceedings. Even though the Pope, Gregorio XI, eventually did return to the city in 1377, a canonization process takes a long time. That Katarina died in 1381 didn't help. Not until Queen Margrethe of Denmark, Norway and Sweden intervened in 1389 by writing a letter to the Pope, things began to move faster. On October the 7th, 1391, Birgitta Birgersdotter was canonized by the Pope. In 1999, she was declared patron saint of Europe.